This video is brought to you by Native. Energy storage is the holy grail of decarbonization. If we want to get rid of fossil fuels for good, we need to be able to store a large amount of surplus renewables over time. The current technologies available, like lithium-ion batteries, may not have enough capacity to meet our power storage demand in the future. But what if we could turn our houses and buildings themselves into batteries? I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. While the price of renewables keeps falling, we still waste too much of it. And that's because we don't have enough space to store the surplus clean energy when we don't need it, so that we can reuse it when the sunshine and wind are nowhere to be seen. The only way to shift renewables around is to rely on large-scale storage systems. It's for that reason that grid operators are throwing billions of dollars at lithium-ion batteries, which have high energy density and are the most ready-to-store technology that's available today. In the US alone, installations are expected to increase 100 times by 2030. However, lithium is 2,000 times less abundant than other metals like iron, which makes it more expensive. Now, although lithium-ion batteries have become much cheaper over the last decade, some experts think we're going to struggle to make drastic improvements in terms of cost, energy density, and charging speed as that trend has slowed. Another drawback of lithium-ion battery packs is that as they go through charging and recharging cycles, their capacity degrades over time. And for all of those reasons, it's wise to keep looking for feasible alternatives. For example, what if I told you that cement could power your home? Researchers from Chalmers University of Technology in Sweden recently developed a prototype for a rechargeable cement-based battery. With an average energy density of 7 watt-hours per square meter, or about 0.7 watt-hours per square foot, the device held 10 times more power than cement batteries produced in the past. Not to mention it's the world's first rechargeable cement-based battery ever proved at lab scale. The Chalmers researchers' original idea was to integrate their concrete batteries into solar panel systems to store surplus solar energy. However, the potential of this invention is its storage capacity scale-up. That's because you could incorporate this functional concrete into the structure of multi-story buildings to store large volumes of energy. Think of a skyscraper like the Burj Khalifa in Dubai. That would turn it into the biggest battery on the planet, which is kind of crazy. And to add to that, with concrete batteries, you can hit two birds with one stone, since it's both a construction material and an energy storage unit, which could be cheaper overall. I wonder if you could drop your phone on your floor tile and charge it wirelessly. So why cement? Well, concrete isn't a sustainable material by itself, as its production is responsible for 2.4% of global CO2 emissions. However, while more eco-friendly construction materials are mushrooming like fungus, or shooting up towards the sky like bamboo, we won't be able to get rid of cement that easily. Being second only to water, concrete is the most consumed material on Earth. In construction, we use twice as much concrete as all other building materials combined, and that's mostly because of its strength and durability. To add to that, some companies are developing carbon capture systems to trap the CO2 released when making concrete. Now, this could decarbonize the cement production process and make it greener, but not completely green. Perhaps I should build on that in a separate video. In the meantime, why not make the most out of gray concrete and turn cement structures into huge power banks? But how would that actually work? Let's look at how this concrete battery is actually made. The design is inspired by the battery invented by Thomas Edison 120 years ago. In the device, you have ions moving through an electrolyte solution between a positively charged nickel cathode and a negatively charged iron anode. The ion's motion then generates an electrical potential. The main difference compared to the Edison model is that this Swedish scientist used cement mortar as the electrolyte. But they also thought outside the concrete box, tweaking previous similar models. To make the cement slurry more conductive, researchers spiked it with short carbon fibers. Scientists also used an ion exchange resin as a separator between the two electrodes. This porous membrane makes it easy for the ions to move from one pole to the other, which increases the ionic conductivity. On top of that, they applied an alternative method for adding the metallic electrodes to the cement paste. Based on the conventional technique, you would just mix metallic powder particles with a cement slurry. But this isn't exactly that safe, especially when you use nickel. Instead, they coated nickel and iron onto carbon mesh layers and then slid them into the cement-based mix to work as electrode plates. Using this approach, researchers achieved a better electrical performance, reaching an energy density 10 times higher than what they hit when using the traditional powder mixing technique. Now, during charging and recharging cycles, both metals go through a reversible electrochemical process. It's the redox reaction, which is what makes the device rechargeable. Now, I can hear you already. Will my house electrocute me? I think it's pretty unlikely, as you'd be in contact with cement, which is a poor conductor by itself. This means it will isolate your fingers from the electricity safely stored inside the battery. And turning our houses into giant batteries is electrifying, but it's not just about energy storage. There are a number of other applications to consider for these devices. But before I get into that, I'd like to thank Native for sponsoring this video. Native is a really cool company that makes personal care products that are all made from simple ingredients. You'll be able to recognize everything on the ingredient list, and you won't find anything like aluminum, parabens, or sulfates. On top of that, they smell fantastic and are very smooth to apply. I've been using their deodorants in the oat milk latte, charcoal, and aloe and green tea scents, and I'm absolutely loving them. Charcoal actually might be one of my favorites. It just smells clean. These deodorants are vegan and cruelty-free, but one of the things I've been more conscious of recently is how much plastic I'm using and trying to recycle. If you don't know about plastic recycling, it's not going very well. Native offers plastic-free versions of their products, and it's great to see a company using plastic alternatives. And they're made from paperboard that's sourced from responsibly managed forests. And Native gives 1% of all their plastic-free sales to environmental nonprofits. 3 plastic-free deodorants are normally $39, but if you use my link and code UNDECIDED, you'll get them for $29, which is 25% off. Make sure to check out Native's new limited edition holiday scents, all available in plastic-free packaging, including sugar cookie, candy cane, and fresh mistletoe. Check the link in the description, and thanks to Native and to all of you for supporting the channel. So back to some of the other applications for this tech. According to the study's authors, concrete batteries could be coupled with solar cell panels to provide electricity and act as a monitoring system. This could be a great case for highways or bridges, where battery-powered sensors could detect cracks or any sign of corrosion before it's too late. Another study engineered a battery made of cement and seawater to monitor the corrosion of marine infrastructure. Other than being prompt corrosion wardens, building embedded batteries could play a key role in the development of future smart cities by powering automated street LED lighting and Internet of Things-enabled sensors. In their lab test, the Chalmers group used one of their devices to light a small LED lamp for several hours. Another interesting idea would be to use concrete batteries to provide high-speed Wi-Fi connections for structures in remote areas. Besides the Swedish researchers, someone else has contributed to cement this idea. 3 years ago, another research group from the Lancaster University in the UK had developed a cement battery. In this case, the secret recipe was a mix of fly ash and a potassium-based alkaline solution to conduct electricity. This alternative cement design doesn't contain expensive materials like graphene or carbon nanotubes, and is cheaper to make than traditional Portland cement. Now, although the composition is different from the Chalmers product, the British innovation would also build another powerful brick in your wall. This low-cost cement can store and deliver up to 500 watts per square meter, or 46.5 watts per square foot. To give this some perspective, one of the study's authors claimed a 6-meter-tall lamppost made from this material could shine its own renewable light throughout the entire night. Also, just like the Swedish concrete battery, this device could be used for monitoring applications. For instance, you could build a smart curbstone that powers sensors for checking traffic and air pollution. On top of that, any cracks or structural stresses would change the way that the potassium ions move throughout the material, which would give a heads up for maintenance without installing additional sensors. That sounds edifying, right? But there are some concrete challenges to overcome. First of all, the building battery has got a level of energy density which is lower than the ground floor. A square meter, or about 11 square feet of this material, would host as much energy as 2 AA batteries. To give a sense of scale, one of the study's authors claimed 200 square meters of the rechargeable concrete could supply only about 8% of the electricity consumed by a typical US home in a day. And when you compare it to lithium-ion batteries, the functional concrete's energy density is 400 times lower. But how long will it last? The prototype is supposed to have an extended lifespan, as it's based on the long-lasting Edison battery that can work for many years. The authors tout that their battery can resist overcharging, and you can abuse it as much as you want without affecting its performance. However, the Swedish study only tested the performance of the device over 6 charging and discharging cycles. But the cyclic capacity of the device will have to be validated over a high number of cycles to ensure a reliable power storage over time. Plus, concrete buildings are designed to last hundreds of years, so technology improvements should either significantly extend the duration of the battery or make them easier to exchange or recycle once they become exhausted. And of course, we should consider the actual cost of this storage technology, which hasn't been addressed yet. As admitted by the scientists themselves, their design is a good distance away from today's rechargeable batteries. As for their British competitor, the researchers have been optimizing the material composition. They're also trying to 3D print their smart cement to mold it into different shapes. This could drive the production cost further down and bring in new applications. But considering the technology has just taken off from the starting blocks, the devices can be significantly optimized in the near future. While there's nothing set in cement at the moment, storing clean energy in our houses and buildings would reduce their carbon footprint. And remember that although current concrete batteries have a much lower energy density than commercial ones, we would compensate for that by incorporating tons of them into our high-rise buildings. And volume matters, at least in this case. At this stage, this doesn't feel like a replacement for any of the technologies currently available today, but it could be a great add-on. But what do you think? Does it sound too good to be true? Do you think alternative battery technologies like this have a shot? Jump into the comments and let me know. And thanks as always to all my patrons, your direct support really does help with producing these videos. And speaking of which, if you like this video, be sure to check out one of the ones I have linked to right here, and subscribe and hit that notification bell if you think I've earned it. Thanks so much for watching, I'll see you in the next one.